Welcome, everybody. I'm Tammy Salisbury. I'm the Executive Director of Paint Creek Center for the Arts that you are here within. We want to welcome everybody to this exhibition. We're very proud to have Patricia and Roger's body of work here and excited to hear about the discussion. I want to just introduce you to the center a little bit. We are the regional arts center here in the greater Rochester area. We have an art school in this building, obviously art exhibitions that we showcase the work of emerging and established artists every 6 weeks. This completely is transformed by Megan. And then we also have the art market in the lobby. For many of you that don't know, we produce the Art Naples Festival. There's a total of 5 people that work here, and we work year-round to produce the Art Naples Festival, which is now ranked nationally number 15, so out of 2,000 festivals, so we're very proud of that. That event supplies about 65% of our operating revenue to function year-round. So anyways, I just wanted to give you a little introduction to the center, and without further ado, I'll introduce Megan Stone, who will get the talk started. Okay.
Thank you guys for coming. I manage the exhibitions art market, the artist for the Art Naples Festival. I'm just gonna be kind of mediating the talk with Roger and Patricia. So both of you, welcome, and thank you for being artists making amazing work. Maybe, I don't know who wants to start first, but can you just both talk about your work in the show and some things that are interesting about your process?
I think the show is phenomenal in the fact that our work goes so well together, it seems like, and complements one another.
Definitely.
And my work is just about all three-dimensional. I've got a woodcut print over there. But working with wood has really been overwhelming for me. It's become very much not just a habit, but something that I do, very compulsive about it. So I work at it every day. I look at it differently. The wood itself is, it helps guide me on some things, but at the same time, I do have plans before I begin with it. I will actually start with an idea in mind. I actually see the finished product, and then I just try to work towards it. And if I see an opportunity, I go with it. So this is a highlight for me to be here with Pat and all of her work.
Can you describe the process a little bit more? I mean, how you turn a piece of wood into these?
Woodworking itself, I probably started doing when I was a small kid in the backyard, finding wood and basically whittling or trying to use a saw to make something or other. Usually probably a small gun or something. I'm talking pretty young. And my father always encouraged me to do more. So as I got older, woodworking requires a financial investment for the equipment. And so I would always try to do something in the different homes we lived in, you know, whether it's cabinets or furniture. And somewhere down the line in the 80s, I did acquire a lathe. And the lathe, and it wasn't until till around 2000 did I really get overly involved with the lathe. You still need the other equipment to do woodworking, but the lathe is where the creativity really seemed to come alive. And for most wood turners, there were woodworkers beforehand, and they do feel that same way. It's a fact of creativity. The wood is mounted on a big machine, spins towards you, and you use these sharp chisels to cut away and shape the wood. And the additional part, like that lady on the wall over there, the bronze lady, that never made it to a lathe. That was all just carving, and it was out of a solid block of wood, and so it took quite a while to carve away all the wood and leave what is there. So I've gotten more not away from the lathe, but in addition to it, with a lot of things, I'll do some carving on it. It seems to just bring the piece alive, and the color. You know, if the wood is fairly plain, I like to use color. You know, I've got 4 platters up on a wall back there that it's a sky series, and you have a sunrise, a day sky, sunset and the night sky. And to me, that I must be fascinated by sunsets and sunrises because a lot of my work goes in those colors. And it does force me to learn more and more on the color, on the carving. If I've already got that mental image of what I want to accomplish, I have to sometimes learn how to accomplish it. So it's since around 2000 or so, the wood turning has become a lot more of a factor, and I continue to do more sculptural work and really enjoy it. And even as a kid, I would, my wife told me we'd go on a date, and once in a while I'd buy a chunk of clay and we'd each, she said she'd have a ball and I'd end up with something at the end of the night. So it was a cheap date, but so I the sculptural 3D aspect I've always had the interest in.
Pat, do you want to talk about your work?
Okay, well, first I want to thank everybody for being here because I know that summer has a lot of things to do and a lot of plans, so I appreciate you being here today. Second, as few of you know that I'm from Colombia, and doesn't matter how many years I've been here, I still can't pronounce some words well, like turtle and stuff like that. And if I get a little bit nervous, then it goes downhill from there. But so if anybody wants to ask about something that I said, it's okay with that. And I also appreciate, and it's an honor to show my work here. And I thank everybody that put this together, especially to Megan Stone, because she did a wonderful job. The way she put the colors together, I think is amazing.
Yes, it is.
So my work, this is pretty much abstract, and I've been working in abstracts for the last about 2-3 years. And for me, it was like a challenge because I used to do more of a representational work. And I was always admiring the abstract, and I thought it was a lot more difficult, and it's for me more of a, more demanding, because when you have something to copy from nature or a person or whatever, you have all the information right there. And when you do an abstract, then it's all up to you where to go, it takes longer for me.
Is there anything more interesting about your process? Do you use acrylics? I notice your paintings have sort of a glossy finish to them.
Well, I used to work in watercolors, but the watercolors don't show this strong color like acrylics do. So I fell in love and I do very little watercolor now. So I like to do a lot of collage. And I like to put things on it. And I put all kinds of things on it, and then later on I don't like it. So then there is another layer, and this actually ends up giving depth to the work. And that's why you can see shadows, those are things that didn't work. But at the end, the whole thing goes together well. Mm-hmm.
Maybe can you talk about some of your inspirations and the subject matter?
Sure. I have read a lot about artists that are like Picasso and Giacometti and Degoncielo, I don't know if I'm pronouncing that right, Modigliani. I like stylized work, and that for me is a foundation where I draw my work now. And everybody has influences, and you get influenced by them, by their life, by fellow artists. All my friends paint. I have Patrice over there, is a wonderful artist, and we all see each other's work, and that influences each other. I'm very introspective, and I am always thinking and questioning things and questioning life, so I write a lot of these thoughts. And I put them in a special folder, and this is like my fountain of inspiration for a job, for a painting. And I think it depends on your mood. Even if you're sad, being sad is an inspiration that makes you paint something that is very moving for other people. And the other person can almost tell, or it's my wish that the person can tell the mood that I was in, that I can do that. Also, there's all kinds of inspiration. Like one time I went to a very fancy gallery and they had an art show. And this was like a big shot from New York. And the paintings were a little, I was just wondering about those paintings. I couldn't make any sense. And he was like a big deal. So I went and talked to him and asked him for his inspiration. And he said, oh, I don't know. Sometimes I don't know what to do. And on my way to the studio, I start looking at the cement and all the lines. So I paint that. So it depends. I mean, the most significant things in life can make you think about something and spark a painting.
Richard, where do you draw inspiration for your
piece? You know, my inspiration, a lot of it comes from whether it was studying like architecture, form, shape, is something I see and always have, even as a child. Form and shape and proportions are a huge part of my work. And I agree with Pat, a lot of mine ends up also being from my mood, and ideally will show, hopefully, a positive influence as opposed to me not having a great day. But other things are, and this goes again from my childhood, millstones fascinated me. I've got a collection of millstone, an interpretation of millstones, and gourds are another, the shape. It's just, nature brings such a natural shape to things. And I just try to give my touch to what the wood is with it. And then other pieces like that one, I think I showed you, that Bristol cone pine that's so old that it's just such an amazing piece of wood. It was no artistry other than to know when not to do something, My job was to just let the wood show itself as opposed to me try to enhance it. There is no real enhancing it. So it varies a lot where the inspirations come from. I work with a lot of other wood turners and sculptors, and I think that always helps improve somebody's work, always trying to do a little bit better. So I think that I'm looking to see what else has inspired
wood
me.
Wood itself inspires you.
Wood itself definitely inspires me. Yeah. When I have a phenomenal piece of wood, it just is, it's a delight.
You have so much variation in your bodies of work. Is that like the wood tells you to make it into a plate or a wall piece?
It's a combination of, sometimes the wood is a nice enough piece of wood that I don't want to cover it up. Got the attention span of a gnat, so I'm always going to try something different. But this piece here on the wall, I've got color and copper with it, but you still see all the curl that's in it's a curly birch. And that was probably the most planned out piece I had done. And I think it turned out fine because it's a combination of, if it was just the wood itself flat up there, it really wouldn't have the depth or the feeling that does. And there too, a lot of the turning ends up having a lot to do with the colors, with the sunrise, sunsets, circles, and off center. If you think of it as a planet path, that's what you end up getting with a lot of my work.
Before that, I want to add to what you say. I can honestly say that I have never seen a wood artist like he is. I am amazed because a lot of the wood pieces don't look like wood. They look like ceramic or they look like metal. And it's just such a versatility that you add to every piece.
So well, thank you.
I just love his work.
Yeah. And you guys both use a lot of color and texture, mm-hmm. whether that's dyeing the wood or bringing out its natural colors. Like, you told me something interesting the other day about those pieces on the wall over there, how that's like their natural colors.
Oh, yeah, the those three. Well, one of them, the lower left-hand side, the red platter, is actually, it does have some dye, a small amount of dye on it. But the color of those pieces are all natural. That's the wood. And, you know, the upper one is a purple heart. There's a, that kind of a golden one is a mulberry. And that will continue to become more of a chocolate brown, and a pecan down below. And the one that has the, just the red is a maple. But, you know, the color is, can be phenomenal with a lot of the woods. And just to have enough knowledge to know, or I work hard enough at what I think I work hard enough at what I do, that I don't want to take away from the wood. You know, I could easily have, I think they turned out fine. I could have easily butchered them by over coloring them. When the wood's going to do the work for you, you know, it doesn't seem I need to do a whole lot more.
And Pat, your work's really colorful. How do you choose, you know, the colors that you use in your palette?
I don't know. I just tend to go to these colors. I don't know if it's genetic or what it is. That's what I'm drawn to. It just end up. Sometimes I'm doing too many blue ones or too many green ones, so I start doing red and stuff like that. So I try to vary it.
Yeah, even your monotypes, I can tell they're yours. Like each of you, your work's varies, but you can tell in the same room your work.
I think one of the things that any artist struggles is to try to unify your work, and then you try this, you buy books, you look into this, you try this other thing, and this other artist comes with these new things, then you try that, and then you end up doing all these things, and then finally, I say, I'm not going to look at books or magazine anymore. I'm just going to do my own thing, and this is what comes out. And at the end, just because it's yours, then it's that's unifying.
Yeah.
I do a very similar thing, that if I've something I've seen has an inspiration to me, after I've begun the piece, I will force myself not to look at it, because it could be very easy that I'm going to copy something. I'd rather have it be mine.
It's not exactly copying work, but
no, but
they show
close.
You this is the way to do it. First, you have to put this color on, and then you do that. And the other guy said, no, don't do anything. You have to be very spontaneous doing it. And the other guy said, no, you have to plan it really well. So that's when I gave up. I just do my own thing.
Yep.
Pat, how did you get into painting or making art?
I think it might be genetic or something. I think people say artists are born, other ones say artists are made. In my case, I think I was born with this, I think it's a gift, because in my family, my sister Marcela, the youngest one, she's a wonderful artist, and my brother, who is an architect, he suddenly started doing murals in the garage in our house, and my mother just discovered that after the fact, that when he already started it. Everybody in my family, it tends to be artistic, so you just start doing it.
So you started pretty young then? Did you go to school for painting, or...?
I grew up in a very, very small town, and this is a long time ago, so we didn't have like art school. My mother was always looking for people that could teach me or anything, and we couldn't. So I wanted to be an artist, but she told me that I will starve because people don't make any money, and it's true, but now I went to I'm a medical technologist, we call it bacteriologist, and that's my background. But I always, even when I was working at the end of the day, I will take classes. So I, in California, I went to Cal State Fullerton, And when I came to Michigan, this is a place where I start taking classes. And I came from a 80 degree weather to, I came in the at the beginning of the winter, and when I got out of class, it was like 13 degrees. So I didn't think I was going to survive. But I love it here, and I like the seasons very much. So that's pretty much my journey.
Do you have anything you want to add about like your background, Roger?
Well, you know, as you were talking about where your color goes in the seasons, you know, I think that's a big part of also the reds and the yellows and even, you know, some of the other colors that I utilize. The four seasons are phenomenal, you know, to go out and to really explore what colors that nature does provide us is phenomenal. And I bet you probably do quite a bit of that. Your work seems like you could take advantage of it.
I'm not an outdoor painter. All my friends, oh, let's go and paint outside. And just thinking of all the stuff that I have to bring with me and all the, the tubes of color. I say, no, I just take photos sometimes and I just always paint inside. I used to paint in a very dark dungeon in a basement. And now I have a beautiful studio, but it's also in the basement, but it's very well lit. I wouldn't say nature is my prime inspiration. I just shapes. I like squares a lot, and I just pick up the bright colors.
I would say, for me, it would be probably the nature is a big influence on it. Probably because it is wood, you know, was a living thing.
Of course,
thing.
Yeah, of course.
And then the colors, it just, when you have a plain piece of wood, it's very nice, but to add color to it really makes it.
I love when you put color, very
brings
distinctive.
It to life.
Very distinctive.
Can either of you describe your studio practice, like a typical day in the studio?
Sure. Well, I will start from when I paint, it's like a tsunami. Every book is out, paper flying everywhere. I'm very careful with my painting. There's nothing open, my tubes of paint, my brushes, I'm very careful with them. But it is a mess. But when I finish the painting, I clean everything up to start like a new project. And that's the routine that I go through. Pretty much, I try to be disciplined. I'm going to paint, because if you don't force yourself, you end up just kind of time passes and you don't get doing.
Do you work on multiple pieces at a time, or just?
I'm trying to nowadays, so because I get stuck very often, so I put it there and then wait. And then work on something else, you know, to so I don't have to be stuck there looking what I'm gonna do. So after a while, after it's been there, something comes to mind, and then it's more effective that way.
Magic?
Yeah, I normally I don't know which was right or wrong, but I normally end up working on multiple pieces, and it will go. Sometimes you have to, because the different stages of finishing and sanding, carving, and all that takes a long time, that if you kept at it all the way through, you'd be more prone to errors. So you
true.
Need to, when you're doing a lot of carving, you need to back away from it a while and then come at it a different way. And some of the sculptors that I've actually worked with, gone to class with, have given me great tips where you, some of the carving would be in the four corners, and then, because it's going to change as you continue around a piece, and if it's just fill carving or burning. I usually have one main project going and probably three or so others that are part way through. You know, sometimes with the wood also, some of it you turn out of a log. So you're cutting a log, you turn it out of the log, and you turn it part way down, and then you store it for 3 to 6 months to in chip so that it will shrink and not crack. Then you return it, you remount it, you return it, and what I need to do is really write on that piece what I had planned on it to begin with, because 3 months down the road, I can't remember what I was going to do to that piece.
That happens.
So I've got a lot of bowls sitting around that are just ready to be final turned that I can't remember what I was going to do with them. But
so you guys both provided me with some statements for specific pieces, and I think it'd be interesting to hear maybe about that, like, do you have a favorite piece that's really special to you that's in the show, or something that has a story behind it?
Well, for me, I mean, this sounds funny, but for me, everything is special, and I don't want to sell it, and I want to just keep it like if it was my son or daughter. And it's after a while that I say, well, maybe I can let it go, but it is hard because it's your creation, and you work so hard on it, and some stuff I keep it at the house until I run out of walls, and then I have to sell it, something like that. But over here, one of my favorites is the one behind over there. This is the last piece I did, and the name is Best Laid Plans. A lot of my work has some of the explanation underneath, and it explained the viewer what were my intentions. And things happen, and you have plans in life, and you cannot sometimes get through with it. And that piece is pretty much a representation of that. And I also enjoy the two in the back, the yellow and the red. It took me forever to do those, and it's something that had failed before, and you try so hard, and I just don't let it go, and I just work on it until suddenly something just clicks.
I've got my favorite piece is that one that I've done the least amount of work on, and that's that. It's a Bristol cone pine.
Oh, yeah, you said.
And it looks like a log sitting there and a piece of glass, and it started growing in at a minimum 1176. And I can track the entire history of the wood, that piece of wood. It died in 1880 in a fire, stood for like another 100, 120 years, and under a permit given by the state of Colorado, it only grows between like 6,000 or 7,000 feet elevation and 11,000 on the bad side of the mountain that doesn't get the rain. It's just a real diehard. The oldest one right now in Rocky Mountains is about 2,500 years old in a different stand. And this one, if you think about it, 1176, half of the tree is almost worn away from the elements blowing on it, and they grow that way. So the height of that tree is normally in Colorado's around 25 feet, and they also grow in some mountains in California, and there's one there 5,000 years old. So if the fire hadn't come through, this thing really had a real great shot at being a whole lot older. And like I was saying earlier, to me, it really displays what wood is all about. For the chunk that I did have, I did very little with it, just trying not to goof it up. And I think I accomplished it. And that's one of those pieces, like you're saying, I have hope nobody buys it. I've had several that I've sold I regret selling. But
how do you find it? How do you get a hold of that?
You know, having connections with wood, and I go down to school or the symposiums once a year, and I've made friends in Nashville. A gentleman that owns a cabinet shop and a turner that I see every year, his partner in the business has the friends, and I guess he was originally from Colorado, friends he visits in Colorado that had the permit. They brought the wood back to my friend, and my friend just gave it to me. You can't even buy it.
Oh, you're fortunate.
Yeah, very fortunate. And as I was discovering the wood, I did not know as much about the bristlecone pine as I do now. And as I was discovering more and more about it, I got so excited about it, I would keep calling this guy at work, and I'd say, it's at least 300 years old. Well, it turns out it's well over 700 years old. And then continued to stand, you know. So it's a real fighter. Bristlecone pine is an amazing wood.
Well, thank you, guys, and thank you, everyone, for coming.
Oh, I have a question for Megan. You did not see this whole bevy of work, so how, as the gallery coordinator, did you know that these pieces would go so well together?
In the beginning, like when they proposed
it? They're proposing, right.
Well, they submitted like images of their work, and so...
A portion of their work.
They had pretty much all their work.
Yeah, there's a good like 20 images
or
something. So you get a flavor for what things are going to be.
I had no idea that it would look this good together. But I knew they had both a shared interest in texture and color.
Gotcha.
And so I guess we tried it.
What a masterful decision.
Yes, and it does. It looks phenomenal.
Yeah.
I can't believe how great the work complements one another. If Pat and I think, tried to set it up ourselves, we could never have done it as well as Megan
did. Yes, it's like this group over here with this the green green container and the green paintings in the background.
Yep.
And the gray and the gray. This whole corner is just beautifully put together.
Do each of you have some of your very first pieces that you ever did?
I actually have some watercolors, and for sentimental values, I don't want to get rid of them. And it's something, my art has evolved. Like, I started doing very representational, that almost like photographic, and at the end, that doesn't give me any challenge. So that's why I started doing abstracts. But yeah, I do have two pieces that I hold them dearly.
Unfortunately, I'm more of a prostitute, they'd say. I have one, my oldest piece I have is a small plate and out of cherry, and that was with some real rudimentary tools and all. The only person who can appreciate it is me, so I kept it.
Okay,
and then one bowl that I consider instrumental in taking me to the next level or beyond, I've kept that one also. So that's about it. The rest of them there are a bunch I wish I hadn't sold from early on, but hopefully it's in a good home.
That's all
then
good.
There's nothing more satisfying. I can tell you all the sales that meant the most to me wasn't just the money, it was the people that I could tell they really loved what I had done, and that's very fulfilling.
Yeah.
You know.
Any more questions? Okay, enjoy the show, and thank you for coming.
Thank you.
Thank you.